As-salamu alayka ya 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 khayr al-ana.
This lecture will be touching on probably the most important part of the series for some people, for many. The basic questions of life. Why are we here? Okay, we believe there is a force. I couldn't have come here. The whole universe couldn't have just come by its own. It needs a creator. Why was this whole universe created? Why was I created? We will present the view of Islam. At this point, there will not be rational discussions of why and why not. That will be in another issue. Why would we confirm that God exists and God created? That's the topic of another issue. The topic here is, why did He create me? The Quran mentions in Surah 51, ayahs 56 and 57. I have not created mankind and jinn, which is spirits, but to worship me. I do not want sustenance from them, nor do I want them to feed me. This is the verse. The existence of jinn is another issue. Just like we know, we are made of body and soul. The Prophet, peace be upon him, and the Quran confirm that there are also creatures who are only soul, without body. There are also bodies without souls. Okay. Does that verse mean that we have been created to pray all the time? Absolutely not. Nobody in his right mind would accept that, except a person with an ulterior motive. We mentioned the series here is not addressing these people. So let's look at the meaning of the word first. In the largest encyclopedia of the Arabic language called Lisan al-Arab, worship means obedience with submission, meaning without revolt. Another nice definition that I heard from a nice scholar is that worship means, now he's talking about what it is and its results. Worship is willing obedience leading to eternal happiness. This is the semantic meaning of the word so far. So it's not only praying, it's conforming to the will of our Creator. Worship is obedience with submission. A great companion, the cousin of the Prophet called Ibn Abbas, who was a teenager when the Prophet died. One time the Prophet ﷺ prayed for him, O God, make him be knowledgeable in religion and teach him the interpretation of the Quran. He is called by our scholars the nation's scholar. Ibn Abbas, the cousin of the Prophet, has been hailed as the nation's scholar. In his interpretation of the Quran, he explains the words of this verse, I have not created mankind and jinn but to worship me. He says it means to know me. How does that go? Knowing the mercy of my Creator, knowing His gifts to me, knowing His fine attributes, the more this knowledge grows, the more the love grows, until it reaches the point of adoration and worship. That's the explanation of Ibn Abbas. From that perspective, we notice that the reason for our creation is to come on this earth, on this life, have an experience, be afforded the chance, the opportunity to know our Creator on our own decision and free will and clean mind, to deduce His mercy, start loving Him until it gets to the point of worship. This shows the spiritual depth of the purpose declared in the Quran. We're going to go now deeper into the spiritual address for people with spiritual interests. We're going to quote a verse from the Quran, Surah 7, Ayahs 172, 173. When your Lord brought forth from the children of Adam, from their loins, their descendants, and made them testify about themselves, saying, "Am I not your Lord?" They said, "Yes, indeed, we testify." That was, lest you should say, on the day of resurrection, "We were unaware of this." Or lest you should say, "It's only that our fathers ascribed partners to Allah previously, and we were but a seed after them. Will you then destroy us because of deeds by those who commit falsehood?" These verses, these ayahs of the Quran, are mentioning a spiritual happening. Scholars explained, as the verse says, a happening beyond time, when our spirits were addressed by our Creator, "Am I not your Lord?" I have read from a scholar that the reason that the soul yearns to hear the beautiful voice is that it remembers that divine speech, "Am I not your Lord?" This is an attempt to describe a facet of the love connection between the created and his creator. Just hearing that voice is something else. There are traces of wonder of having heard this address to us that remain in each of us. But we are in this life as if having woken from a dream where you just forgot the dream. And sometimes you notice, "Oh, I'm starting to remember that dream." This spiritual happening is called by some people that our life is a remembrance process. The more our spirit starts succeeding in experiencing the existence of God, at the same time, the spiritual remembrance of that address keeps growing, and a person will get more illumination in his heart. A person doesn't need to dissect it like that. This was explained. If you ride a bicycle, you don't need to dissect it and explain how your feet are moving, when you're swimming, when you're walking, when you're breathing. The same applies here. Having explained it as such does not require that every Muslim or every person who believes in God has to realize this point. But the belief that brings more spiritual light to the heart is actually a remembrance of that divine, beautiful speech. I have read when I was in high school in one of the philosophy classes by Carl Jung, a philosopher, a very interesting sentence. I don't have the text. Even if Carl Jung didn't say it, it is somewhat interesting that worship exists in one form or another in all societies and cultures across history. Worshipping a statue, worshipping another. Atheists would object to that, but we win by democracy, we are a majority. There will always be exceptions to rules. Yes, atheists are the exceptions. But the majority of mankind have, in a way or another, yearned to worship. Carl Jung, if I remember well, if not, it is a fact, says this is a proof of the existence of an entity of God who put that in them. Of course, materialistic people would have a different explanation. This series of lecture is directed to the person seeking the truth. Please remember that atheists and materialistic people commit the grave, irrational fallacy of never accepting to look at the world with the potential idea, let's assume that God exists and made it. Does it fit the puzzle more or less? They will never want to do that. This is unscientific. Incorrect science, when you have a phenomenon or an event and you want to analyze it, you have to consider all the alternatives, no matter how probable or improbable. The one that fits and explains the facts the best will be the one to accept. One cannot prevent a witness from attending court. Okay? So this was the words that I might remember correctly from Carl Jung, but actually, the yearning to worship the owner of that sublime speech is what explains to the believers, is what explains the yearning to worship. And when man is left without correct guidance, the object of worship will not be the correct one. That's why mankind has always been in need of messengers. Our Creator mentions to us in the Quran that no nation has passed without having sent a messenger to them, in generalities. Each nation has received a messenger. So for the Muslim who reads this ayah, whether it is India, whether it is Japan, whether it is Kamchatka, whether it is the Eskimos, there have been messengers with a message sent to them. The atheists are called in Arabic kafir. The word kafir so nicely coincides 100% with the word cover in English. The word kafir does not initially mean atheist, unbeliever. It means coverer. So people who do not believe in God, by definition, are people who cover. They are the ones who are covering this memory. I pray to Allah that you will not be one of them. Our attempt is not to cover by stubbornly refusing to consider the possibility that God exists. Conversely, the less we cover, the more we get purified. And the thinner the veil becomes between us and that memory. The less stubborn we become against ideas of the existence of God, the more we will be able to recollect. The more the illumination, the spiritual light will grow, and the reinforcement will start occurring within our daily experience. There are moments in every believer's life that happen completely way above the spiritual level of the normal day when the person realizes the state of heightened state of the effect of belief, like the hand on a shoulder without speech, pressing you. Keep going, you're on the right path. Many of the listeners would recognize that. I pray our Creator for me and for you more and more of these times. They are at the decision of God. Our Prophet said, Allah has in your ages, He has instance of mercy. Whoever gets reached by one of those winds of mercy will probably never be miserable again. So he said, the Prophet, get exposed to those instants of mercy. He means keep seeking to do the deeds that you read, that you heard, that you learned, that your Creator loves. Because one day you'll be touched by one of those breathings of mercy. Mentioning Allah in our hearts, just like it was discussed in the introduction, worshiping God as if you see Him, and if you don't see Him, that He's seeing you, that's called remembering Allah, right? Remember God. This is called in Arabic zikr. More frequent mentioning of God in our heart, in our daily life, also helps to purify our souls, make this veil thinner that lies between us and this divine light that can reach our hearts and our souls to the point of almost feeling its physicality. In the Quran, Allah mentions concerning normal obedient subjects, we will grant him a fine life. That's the minimum. This is verse 97 of Surah 16. Another ayah in the Quran states, and I don't have the number, it's a very often quoted ayah, is it not that with the mention of Allah do hearts find peace? أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ. This is where the mention of Allah brings peace to the heart, the mention of our Creator. Now, that was, as I said, concerning normal obedient subjects. With more dedication and perseverance, more will happen. One of the great righteous persons in Islam said, we are in a bliss. If the kings knew about, they would fight us over it with swords. This is a report about this type of bliss when the person gets nearer and nearer to perceiving in his heart the light of our Creator, in his heart. That had to do with this life. In the hereafter, in Surah 9, Ayah 72, Allah promised the believers, men and women, gardens under which rivers are flowing, remaining forever therein, and fine abodes in the gardens of Eden, and greater good pleasure from Allah, meaning His acceptance, meaning His love acceptance. That is the supreme triumph. End of the ayah. Must be noted here that those who mock a partial quotation from this ayah, rivers, maidens, virgins, ha, Islam is so materialistic. Persons who speak in that manner are indeed the more materialistic ones. By dropping the most important part of it, as stated in the ayah, that is the supreme triumph. What's the supreme triumph? Maidens? Rivers? No. And greater good pleasure from Allah. And those persons who truncate this verse remind us of a very popular example in the Muslim world concerning another verse where Allah says, O you who believe, that was at the time when the forbidding alcohol was being revealed gradually to the Muslim nations to help them stop it step by step. In the first stages of the process, the verse was revealed, O you who believe, do not kneel prayer while intoxicated until you know what you're saying. The proverb, the nice always similitude is people who say, oh, Allah said, do not kneel prayer, cutting off the remainder of the sentence. It's always a funny thing to mention, and it applies to people criticizing a half of an ayah that they selected, but after omitting the important part of the ayah. Another ayah, Surah 75, ayahs 22-23, mentions about the hereafter, people in paradise, faces radiant that day, looking at their Lord. Mentions it as, this is one of the pleasures of the hereafter. The hereafter as described in Islam describes spiritual and personal pleasures. So we have seen how the word worship in its use in the Quran and its understanding by the highest scholar of Islam conveys the meaning of knowing our Creator to the point of loving Him, to the point of worshiping Him. In here, we can refer to the meaning of the word worship used by teenagers in societies, wrongly so or rightly so, that's another issue. We're talking about the meaning. When they speak about actors, singers, teenage idols, etc., people who reject religion have no objection understanding what these teenagers mean by the word. And it's very unfair and unreasonable for them to cry wolf, to cry objection, when that same word is used in the same meaning of love, but much higher. That love here includes appreciation of features, appreciation of gifts. These are high moral values appreciated by mature people. It's extremely unreasonable and biased for whatever reasons. I cannot see the reason that would make people get so biased as to object against the word worship and the implications. And the implications in commitment that for Muslims will touch every part of his life. The more the love, the more the responsibility of appreciation, the more the commitment. We turn now to a hadith that coincides in meaning with this ayah that I have created mankind and jinn but to worship me, in the meaning to know me, then love me, then worship me. A weak hadith in the sense that a weak hadith cannot be used to deduce legislation, but it can be used to add understanding, to incite toward moral values or spiritual values. This hadith states, he created creation to be known. As it coincides with the explanation of the ayah by Ibn Abbas, this makes the meaning of the hadith not weak anymore. We have just the textual wording that has not been narrated with a strong chain of narrators. By the way, this gives an appreciation, on purpose these details are given, to give an appreciation of the methodology of checking the truthfulness of what we Muslims accept for our life. You say, we don't take baloney, and the listener would not take baloney. Any story that you get that you would not allow to be used against you in order to pay $10, you should not let a lesser story allow your whole life to be taken from you, your belief. This hadith and the meaning of the ayah indicate that creation is an act of giving. We need to notice that in our minds. This creation, such that some people will be allowed to have the opportunity to act correctly, therefore know him, therefore love him to the point of worship. The end, the worship, is a bliss that starts in this life and ends eternally in the afterlife with it till eternity. This is an act of giving. So creation is out of generosity. To make people for no need, out of no need to the Creator, to make entities that will have a consciousness and that will be able to achieve a high state of their own pleasure out of total giving and mercy. So this feeling and act of worship, we can see now how it has to do with a feeling coming from what is usually called by humans from the heart. It is not from the reason. It is not against reason. When you love your child, when you love your wife or your husband, we're talking about the heart. We're not talking that you love him with your brain, with your intellectual capacities. There would be intellectual features that are in common that will add to this love, etc. But we should not lose focus of the importance of the feeling part of it that has to do with what is called heart. That's important in what we're going to continue now concerning a hadith by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he says, God does not look at your bodies, nor at your forms. Rather, he looks at your hearts. This section allows the Muslim to understand this hadith more. In this hadith, usually the Prophet and us, we understand how it applies to our sincerity with him, to what we do when we are doing some deeds, some good deeds or not, when we're behaving in life. It's a direction to us that it is not the appearances that count, it's the sincerity, it's the heart. Now, when we're talking about worship, it allows a much deeper understanding. It allows us to continue the understanding that we started with. It's all based on a leaning of the heart. Our creation is with the potential of knowing, loving, leaning of the heart to the point of worship. So that worship is not the, even though it's called obedience without revolt, that obedience without revolt is the one that comes from love. That's what's important in it. Subduing some creature by force to worship is not the issue here. The issue here is the worship that come willingly, with feeling. And we're now touching on the issue of willingly, with the freedom of choice. One is free not to accept, to be grateful. No, I owe nothing to what you call a creator. Absolutely nothing. All this is by chance. All the happiness that ever occurred in my life, all the things that I enjoy in my body, in myself, in my surroundings, are total chance. I owe nothing to a superior being. A person is free to say that. Another person who has gone through the minimum attempt to examine, may I owe some gratitude to somebody? I think there's a big difference between the two. We're not here yet at the point of proving the existence of God. We're proving a person is different from another person. A person who passes by your house, receives something that pleases him, helps him, does not care to think if it was from you. And another person who does care and stop and say, let me think. And between the two, a small debate may go on, where one would say, you didn't prove that to me, let me continue my way. And the other says, maybe not 100%, but I don't want to miss the chance to be better than I am today, to be a tad better, and knock on that door and tell them thank you if you're the ones who did it. He didn't beat him with the argument. By the way, this is important, and we'll come to it, how strong the argument of the existence of God. The argument of the existence of God is not such that God wins an argument against me. I am the point of examination. I am the entity that's being examined, not my Lord. The test is mine. It's not humankind that's testing God. Is there a God or not in our lab? We're in the lab, say religious people. We have to find if there's a chance of missing a thank you where it deserves. We do not want to miss it. Sorry, we feel an obligation. On this issue, the Holy Quran mentions clearly, beautifully, if we want, we can descend a sign unto them, to mankind. We can descend a sign unto them from heaven, to which their necks will remain submitted. Okay, God is telling me, you who have a common sense, that his choice concerning me and my race is not to make me believe by force. If he wanted, he would have done it. We will be talking about the proofs of the religion, about the proofs of the existence of God, about the proofs of the Quran. This verse warns us, even though other verses point to a proof, this verse, as well as the other verses, warns us not to go too much far-fetching to the utmost of debate, because it is not made to bend my mind and break it by force. There is no mathematical definite proof. There is no physical or logical definite proof such that any reasonable and literate person who's gotten a degree, who passes an IQ test above 50%, whereby all those would agree unanimously that there is a God. Our Creator did not choose that for this race. Just because of what have just been mentioned, there is a degree of uncertainty left on purpose because our race is not only a computer, a brain, or cells. It is also a morality and a sense of appreciation of what's been done to me. In the Holy Quran, in the first surah, our great Lord says, "We have indeed shown the signs to people who have certitude." If the person is capable to allow himself, will allow himself to have certitude, meaning will not reject it, like the example of the two people passing the house. One of them is just rejecting to see. That one, according to the ayah, if we're now talking about religious matters, does not want to accept to have certitude. The signs have been shown, not by force. There are more reasons for that. We're coming to them one by one. So we go back now to the results of worship, to the description of worship as ending in love, as the love, the utmost love that leads to total worship and submission and acceptance and obedience. That is not toward a goal of creating a species that will be walking semi-drunk all the time with his love. Something like that will happen in the hereafter. In this life, nirvana style, drunkenness style, is not the one intended by worship. The pleasures of worship in this life, are the carrot that keeps encouraging us, that keep comforting you. You're on the right path. As such, from this creation and from this sense of worship, there ensues responsibility for the person who admitted the love, who have felt the love and reached from this love to this worship. The natural result is responsibility toward the goal. We've touched on the goal already now. Appreciation of a lot of stuff from this Creator. This will be mentioned here and there in the whole series. We're starting to touch on it. So, I have a responsibility toward myself. Now, once I have perceived the possibility of the existence of a Creator and refused to run away from considering it, because I don't want to be ungrateful if that was the case, I'll give it another thought. I'll look at it more. What have I got to win? What have I got to lose? Personally, on the personal level, and on the moral level, what have I got to lose and win? There will also be responsibility to others, such that my actions and my life does not hurt them. Everybody accepts these principles and does not hurt their strive toward the end that I have, nor the goals that they set themselves in life, even if they don't believe in my Creator, as long as we don't conflict, as long as our interests don't overlap and hurt each other. That's society. By the way, some of the objections, I would say simple simplified objections against religions that include acts of worship and do not want to accept what they know, that normally things of value that have taken some effort are usually the more appreciated in life. Muslims who follow rules do not feel a burden. It's weird that the burden of acts of worship, especially in Islam, is felt by its critics, not by Muslims. My, this is nice and weird. Muslims enjoy what people who don't do the actions call them as burdens. Now, we're talking about an issue mostly by Christian preachers who want to increase their flock. Look, why do those things? It's not by your actions that you're going to enter paradise. I hope they'll stick to that. By the way, as we'll see very soon now, it is not by our actions that we wish to enter, that we hope to enter paradise. Anybody who claims that concerning Islam, I won't use foul language against him. I'll just say he is not telling the truth, and probably he knows it. Anybody who has some professional conscience, professional ethics, has some PhD in theology and philosophy, if he needs to talk about Islam, needs to read what Muslims say on this issue. If he did not, this is not a person I would want to follow. We'll see soon. So it is weird that the cores of acts of worship are felt by people who don't do them, and people who do them enjoy them. By the way, as we will see through the whole series, Muslims not only feel the pleasure of these acts of worship, the spiritual pleasure, the family positive results, the social positive results, the human positive results, even with people from other religions, even with the enemy. The Quran says, push away with the better deeds. You will find that the person who was your enemy becomes your best friend. That's the approximate meaning. Yeah, we have instructions on everything, on things that people who attack Islam and want to soil your mind would never want you to read, would never want you to know. So these acts of worship, these restrictions fulfill us. We will see, God willing, through this series,